Welcome, everybody. My name's Claire Maloney, and for those of you who are encountering the exhibition and this project for the first time, I'd just like to give you a bit of background. I'm part of a group called Gaze on Gaza. We formed last year during the invasion of Gaza. We are a bunch of curators, writers, creative producers, and we just felt moved to do something positive in response to what was happening. We weren't experts in any way, but we thought we could use what we do as artists and creative people to focus mainstream and media attention on the situation in Gaza, particularly post-ceasefire, because there is, as I'm sure many of you know, an extreme humanitarian crisis going on. We decided we would commission an artist based in Gaza to produce a work that directly communicated their experiences of the invasion, but also its legacy. And we commissioned the young artist Majal Natil, who produced this work here on the wall, this installation, If I Wasn't There. And it's 400 drawings drawn on the paper bags used to deliver cement to people who lost their homes during the invasion in Gaza. And each work imagines the futures, the aspirations, the dreams of the children who lost their lives during the invasion. We've put together this show, Gaza and Gaza, with two other partners, one of which is Christian Aid. And they worked with a group of Palestinian teenagers through one of their partner organizations in Gaza called the Culture and Three Fort Association. And they worked with teenagers in an arts therapy context to help them address their trauma and the trauma of many of their peers and people that they knew in Gaza. And if you've been downstairs, those are the drawings on the wall. Those were done by the Palestinian teenagers. Another partner is the Palestinian Arts Festival, and they curated a series of digital media works and moving image works from emerging and established artists in Gaza. So this show, Gaza and Gaza, is meant to obviously shine a light on what's happening in Gaza right now and the conditions under blockade and occupation, which are very hard for most people. But it's also about shining a light on the quite dynamic art scene in Gaza, which despite the many obstacles and challenges, people are still managing to practice and make really interesting work. So I think that's a really important function of this exhibition, and also our discussion tonight, which is art as intervention. Can art help build a better future for Palestinians? I'm going to introduce our guests in a second, but this isn't a didactic discussion. We want it to be a conversation. So I think I'm really keen to hear lots of practical ideas in response to this question, the role of art as intervention. So please do join in. And Mikey, who I'll hand over to in a second, is going to explain how that will work and how you can contribute. So I just want to introduce our speakers. So Selma Dabbagh is a Palestinian writer based in London. Her first novel, Out of It, is set between Gaza, London, and the Gulf, and was a Guardian Book of the Year in 2011 and 2012. She's also published a collection of short stories, and in 2014, her first play, The Brick, set in Jerusalem, was broadcast on BBC Radio 4. She's currently working on her second novel, and you've got copies of Out of It here tonight, so I'm going to buy one, so get them while they're here. Miranda Pennell is an artist filmmaker and member of Artists for Palestine UK. Artists for Palestine UK is a network of artists, cultural workers and activists who wish to make a stand in support of justice and equality for Palestinians and to defend arts organisations and individuals taking a stand against politically motivated attacks and censorship. Artists for Palestine promote open and informed discussion on the responsibilities of artists and situate this debate in the context of the Palestinian appeal for a non-violent movement for boycott, divestment and sanctions against Israel. And they've produced this amazing book which really clearly sets out the case for BDS, and that is also available tonight. So come and see Miranda if you would like a copy. Kareem Samara is a multi-instrumentalist and composer from London. He's also the co-founder of multicultural music collective RAST, who hosts East in East, a regular event in Dalston that promotes contemporary Arabic arts, including film, poetry, and music. we have Aimee Shalan. Aimee is the co-director of Pressure Cooker Arts, an arts and advocacy organisation focusing on the Middle East and exploring the vital role that arts can play in challenging attitudes and inspiring political action. Pressure Cooker Arts facilitates creative partnerships between artists, activists and community-based organisations, helping them to produce work that engages new audiences and raises international awareness. They also provide advocacy support for organisations working with communities under pressure in the Middle East and organise events to promote the culture and cuisine of the communities they work with. Finally, last but not least, we have James Walmsley, a curator based in Manchester. James is passionate about art, social justice and human rights, and he has been visiting Palestine regularly for a number of years and recently went to Gaza to connect with artists there. He is hoping to bring an exhibition of leading Gaza-based artists to the UK in 2016. He's previously worked with the National Gallery in Zimbabwe, Manchester Art Gallery, National Gallery Kosovo, and most recently, the People's History Museum in Manchester. Those are our guests for this evening. So can I hand over to Mikey Winecove, who's going to facilitate the discussion.
Thanks, Claire. Before we get into this discussion, I just want to, just for those that don't know what Talkaoke is, it's a discussion format which seeks to really get the intelligence of everybody in the room. So it's kind of, yeah, we're going to go on a journey. We don't know where that journey is going to be. We're going to hear from our invited speakers, but we also want to hear from you. And we want to get your thoughts, and not just the thoughts that you've been thinking. We want the thoughts that you've been thinking all along, but also what your responses to what people are saying here today, because, you know, we want to move this conversation onwards. In a way, it feels kind of like we've come full circle, because now we're having a conversation about, I guess, the framing of the conversation is what can us as artists, creative people, people involved in the arts, actually do to see the change that we want to see happening. So that's the kind of framing for tonight. But what that means is we need your contributions as well. First up, I'm going to go to Selma. You've got a few things you want to say, and then we're just going to get the ball rolling and get some responses, both from our invited speakers and from you people.
Please do.
Come and sit here. It makes me look more. Makes me feel, you know, like you know, makes it feel better. Come and have a seat. Come and get involved. Come and sit down. Come closer. You're all welcome to sit around this table, and have a seat. Have a say. Okay. So over to you, Selma. If you want to kick this off, and we'll see what responses come out from that.
Okay. Thank you, Mikey. Thank you, Claire. Thanks for inviting me and for all of you for coming this evening. I've got 5 minutes, so I'm just going to say a couple of things, not necessarily connected, but a couple of points that I'm throwing out about this, because it's a huge topic. I think, obviously, for this audience, probably the assumption that ending the occupation and the apartheid is the main thing that will help the Palestinians. But if we're going to be looking at art... As a way of creating a better future for Palestinians, there are some things that I think I can comment on from my experience of writing a novel on Palestine, short stories, and a play. First of all, it's like, who are you talking about in terms of it helping? And sometimes the work which is being produced, it's never going to get much further than the person who's producing it. I mean, if you think about just writing a thought or a feeling and it disappearing or being slipped under a pillow at night, or you're thinking about something which is going to actually go somewhere and be published more broadly, I would say that both of them have a certain beneficial value and a certain... there's a catharsis in the process of writing and explaining and narrating and of feeling something through in a way that you might find satisfying. So even if it ends with you, I think there's always a benefit in trying to explain oneself and to explain a situation around oneself, which is of no small consequence when you look at anything like the mental health statistics in somewhere like the occupied territories, which are so devastating at the moment, that anything that is able to help create a sense or a pattern has an extreme value to not just the individual but to society. So there's a comfort value. I mean, I'm very much Palestinian, Aimee and Kareem as well. We're Palestinians from the diaspora, really. And for us, there's sometimes, by creating a story which explains an experience which might be specific to our particular way of being Palestinian, it's a way of connecting up and a way of feeling part of something which you might have felt previously excluded from. So that was something that I was dealing with my book, was to look more at the different groupings of Palestinians and how we can find commonality rather than the things that separate us in terms of our commitment towards our political consciousness. The other point I'd make is really with regards to the creation of beauty in itself. And there's sometimes a view that, the thing that I was really plaguing me when I was writing was Pablo Neruda had this saying where he said, how can one write about, you know, the beauty of a flower or a mountain when you've got the blood of children running in the streets? So the idea that why spend time on something which isn't immediately addressing a political situation. But with the Palestinian occupation being so long-standing, you've got people living and dying under a continuous state of occupation. So does that mean there is no place within this for an examination of love or beauty in nature, etc.? So where is that space? And I think some examination of where that space is quite an interesting debate. But last point is just for me, and I think Palestinian writers vary a lot on this, but for me, I don't know that art as a way of necessarily forming a message in a propagandist way is necessarily always that... And this balances out with the idea of art creating beauty, is that I think that sometimes to push forward with the idea of art as just a way of communicating out a message to the West, which is sometimes an expectation you feel put upon you, I think that sometimes has to be resisted, taking other considerations into account and other artistic concerns, because it can implode the form.
Okay. I mean, there's a lot there. Does anyone want to respond to any of those points? Can we talk about beauty when there's blood running in the streets? Is it a necessity? There's many different things and ways that art and artistic practices and creative practices can work. Do they nullify each other, or do they actually enhance each other? Some of the things, I guess... brought up from Selma's few points. Anyone want to respond straight off?
Well, I will, because it sort of touches on some of the things I was going to talk about as well. And I guess sort of on the political side that you sort of ended on there, because I wanted to start by sort of tackling the question of whether art can build a better future by looking at some of the politics of the question in terms of what the role of art has already played in the politics of Israel-Palestine, what we actually mean when we're talking about the better future. You know, is it ameliorating their current conditions, or are we talking about something else, you know, ending the occupation, all of these other things? But also in what context art and cultural exchange could prove damaging under certain circumstances as well. And I think that art has been very useful for Palestinians in the sense of having a very potent role of historicizing and refashioning the Palestinian struggle, and also serving as a sort of critical form of self-preservation and cultural resistance. But when you talk about cultural resistance, there's obviously the threat that that's going to lead to the impoverishment of the artistic form, as you were saying. And I think that so much, I mean, one of the great credits to Palestinian art is that it has resisted that threat hugely, whether that's through literature, whether it's through fine arts. It seems to me that it's in a very self-critical work has been coming out of Palestine. And it's had a substantial impact both on the cultural and social life within Palestine, but also in terms of being a source of national pride for Palestinians inside and outside, and being a kind of cohesive community a way of making the community more cohesive. In terms of the more political side of things, though, I think the sort of context of the way in which art is produced also by Israel and the way that that has played its part in the history of Palestine, and particularly in recent years, it's been very clear that Israeli politicians take art very seriously. And if we look at Brand Israel, which has been a very concerted effort to sort of rebrand Israel's occupation and dispossession of Palestinians through musicians and filmmakers and fine artists internationally. And I guess the question is how Palestinian art responds to that without falling into the trap of leading to artistic impoverishment is a difficult one. But I think so far the work that's been coming out has been amazing.
Yeah, I think that both of you talked about space as an important part of Palestinian art. And I think that a lot of what you create as an artist is that space that you would, that you want to have. And sometimes in Palestinian art, it's the only place where there is an end to occupation. There is a future. You know, you're not got the idealistic.
It's a kind of freedom.
Yeah, because you can create whatever you want. You know, you can have a story without even talking about it. Could be you know the story could be a love story, but it's set under occupation. You don't have to mention the occupation, but it's there. You know, it always comes through you as an artist, whatever you're doing, whether you're blatantly saying it or not, it will come through as an artist. So I think that the space, the idea of space, is really important, how you create it as a Palestinian artist without resorting to maybe brand Palestine in a way. The other thing is that Palestinian art has always been used by the people in power, especially since the Intifada, the first Intifada, where they took what was the joke, perhaps, of the more middle-class Palestinian, of the village Palestinian with his donkey who doesn't read or write, and the turning of that into what is Palestinian identity, and the way that they can use and manipulate the narrative to build what they would like to build. So, for example, folklore, whether it be dabke or music, it switched around the First Intifada because they wanted to build the resistance. And you have suddenly the person that was kind of the butt of jokes suddenly is your... What does it mean to be Palestinian? You have a picture, and it's usually the person that was always sort of looked down upon. And every group that has ever tried to get any sort of power or any kind of movement have done that in some way, especially in Palestinian society. It's always happened. And I think that that's something that also, it can be good, because it can be good for a good cause, but then it always can have the danger, again, of ruining the artistic...
So there's a kind of double edge there.
Yeah, it's the big double edge sword.
Yeah.
And I mean, it happens in every conflict, and it happens specifically as well in the Palestinian one. The other thing I was going to talk about was the use of art in therapy, specifically the way that it, mental health issues obviously have a huge stigma in many Arabic societies, and especially in places where it doesn't want to be talked about. You know, you have to be resilient and you have to be sturdy and tough. And to talk about someone who has a mental health issue within a community, especially in, say, for example, in the camps in any of the countries that have the camps, Jordan, Syria, Lebanon, you know, the idea that someone within your community that close has this mental health issue, there is a stigma that you don't necessarily know how to deal with it.
Yeah.
And art is a great way of building
kind of conversation.
The conversation, but also Ahmed Tobesi from the Freedom Theatre, when you had the theatre event here, where we had the Skype call with many different theatres across the West Bank and to Gaza, Ahmed Tobesi from Freedom Theatre was saying how they did this thing with the summer workshops with the children, and it's to build confidence. They don't have to go and be an actor, But the idea that you can stand up and sort of speak your mind without fear of even just offending your parents or offending your group, just to say how you actually feel about a situation, to get out that anger that is just kept inside. So art as therapy is another thing that I think is really important.
I mean, it strikes me from what's been said already that in a way, you know, art, and when we say art, I think we mean all kinds of creative practices, are doing so many different things. I think this idea of this kind of free space or this imaginative space, which can't be closed down, is very important. But, you know, there's so many different elements here. Is there a theme, really, to these things? I mean, there's the mental health side, the question of like the brand, be it brand Palestine or brand Israel. There's the art as a kind of as an intentional political prop, but also unintentional as well, that you refer to. So many different elements. So come and sit on the orange chair. Come, we've got a spare. You've got something to say, so that this is exactly what we want.
In relation to the improvement of art, a countryman who said, an artist or curator, I don't do political art, I do art politically. It's quite a famous quote. I'm just going to give two examples of art project that I did that will maybe make my point clearer.
Yeah.
My last work in Tel Aviv was distributing Molotov cocktails in the center of the city, doubled as art objects. Mm. And a project I did here, a small one, with the Palestinian Solidarity Campaign, selling art prints which relate to the Gaza war and to the Nakba, printed on sanding paper. Or on burned wood.
Yeah.
Now, it will be difficult to sell this kind of art, but it's an art form that also criticized how the art market itself.
The
thing
works,
is that as an artist or in a Catch 22, because if you won't get into the art market with the Palestinian theme or any other political theme. The artist intervention, which I think it's really important, art and intervention usually is financed by charities or by governmental agencies. If you won't get into the market with your more traditional art, you won't have much chances to get the funds to do this kind of work that we see actually in this gallery in quite an amazing way.
I mean, is the market kind of, let's say, is the market, the art market, against Palestine? What do people think? Come forward. You've got another. Come and have a seat. Stay there. Come there. Have a seat over there. Have a seat. Yeah.
Just picking up on something that was said at that event that Kareem mentioned, when lots of us were here, and there were the six companies. Yeah. It was Abdel Fattah Abu Sroor from Al Awad, who said about the funding question and the being given the space to work. First of all, he said the powers that be within Palestinian society really don't prioritize art, so they're not, they've got other concerns. The other thing he said, which I found interesting, I'd love to know what other people think, is that foreign NGOs who might help, have their own agendas, and that those agendas, their projects, may not actually fit with what is needed within Palestinian communities and among Palestinian artists.
Can you give us an example of how the agenda clashes?
I'm afraid I can't, because I'm just quoting him.
Okay,
right. I was hoping that
maybe someone else can.
Exactly. Yeah. I'm going to go back to my seat.
You're welcome to stay there. Agendas clash. I mean, I guess everyone's got an agenda. We've all got an agenda. James?
No, just going back to what the gentleman said, I asked a friend of mine, an artist who lives in Bet Jala, Rana Bishara. So I gave her the question that we're discussing, can art help build a better future for Palestinians? And this is what she said. The tradition of political art has taught us that art plays a significant role in bringing about social justice. It contributes to mobilizing the public through engaging and immersive means. For me, the personal is political and vice versa, as every aspect of our lives is affected by political decisions. In occupied Palestine, the ongoing ethnic cleansing, theft of land and water, buildings illegal settlements and imprisoning a whole population in ghettos through the use of old and new colonial forms of control and surveillance affects every Palestinian. I am most interested in creating a form of public intervention through integrating art with the Palestinians' daily resistance against Israel's colonialism. My strong belief is that artists should express the grave violations of human rights and express the dreams and aspirations of the people by being present in the midst of their daily struggle.
James, can I just ask you, what does that art look like if it's art that's kind of integrated, as you said, into that daily struggle? What does it actually look like? What kind of things does she do? I think it'd be good to get some real examples so we can understand.
I'd rather show you the images themselves,
yeah,
really,
which I can't. We can put the images
well,
on the screen.
We could look them up. I mean, Rana is coming from, you know, a very powerful point of activism, and her work is very political.
Do you agree or disagree that there's a difference between making art politically and making political art?
Going back to the idea of an art market, I think from the work that I've done in Zimbabwe and Kosovo, is there isn't really an art market, and the artists who I'm working with are creating art to speak out against an injustice, so hopefully conditions will improve, and then there may eventually be an art market. So it's very much about
a kind of future art market in a way.
Well, it's not really something I engage in. It's really about just trying to give those artists a platform, potentially in the UK, to promote their work.
I mean, what do they think about the idea of an art market? Is it something they want to be involved in, or is it something that's totally
relevant
to them? Yes,
of course, because we all have families. We all want to create opportunities for our families to have better lives, for people to travel. Of course, people, have financial concerns. But again, so of course artists want their work to be recognised. But again, I exhibited the work of a New York Times photographer and his work from Iraq, and it was, deeply disturbing images.
Right.
And who would want to buy that? Except a specialist museum or collector, potentially, or say the Imperial War Museum, or so.
The market's secondary to actually this sense
for most of the artists I work with. Yeah, it's about communication primarily, but of course they still, have needs like everybody else.
Okay.
Just wanted to come back to the question about NGOs and funding as well, because I was previously working, heading the advocacy unit at Medical Aid for Palestinians, and part of the reason why I left and sort of set up Pressure Cooker Arts was very much with a frustration around what gets funded, what the limits are, how one communicates, all of those sorts of different restrictions. And coming back to the issue of art therapy, I think one of the big problems is there's a rush of money immediately after conflict into these areas, and these small art projects, which aren't then sustained or sustainable, the money then dries up as the conflict sort of wanes off, and then it comes back again immediately after, and it means that nothing really meaningful can be built out of those sorts of processes. So that's one of the big frustrations.
What would you like to see?
I think, these sorts of organisations or donors' money chases emergency situations. The kind of long-term devastating effect of the suffocation of the occupation is not something that brings in donor money. It's not a sexy idea. It doesn't sell to donors. That's one of the big problems, I think. So there's that issue. And then in terms of the art market as well, and whether it's sort of sellable, I think that it kind of transfers to sort of a much bigger idea about what kind of projects are politically acceptable, and the depoliticization of Palestinian art. You know, that often it's kind of like funders are quite happy to put money into projects so long as they're kind of safe art projects rather than ones that are going to create a bit of a stir.
Kareem was just saying a bit earlier on that even in something which is not political, the situation will come across, and that ostensibly unpolitical, maybe not depoliticized work might have a political element to it. I mean, I don't know if you want to say a bit more about, do you sort of agree with Aimee or?
Yeah, completely agree.
Yeah.
I just feel that the idea of the Palestinian art being politicized or depoliticized, it's like saying that you're a Palestinian is a political statement in itself.
Yeah.
If you identify yourself as Palestinian, it's associated with everything, and it is. I mean, art doesn't exist in a vacuum. Everything comes out. I just feel I don't have anything really to add to it. I definitely agree with it. And regarding Marketplace, I read something recently about an artist from Gaza, Fatih something, I forget his surname, is a really, really popular Palestinian artist. And, you know, he's been making amazing pieces of art for like 20, 30 years, and he can't feed his family. All his money has been stolen by NGOs, by Palestinian art collectors, and he's not got any way of funding and feeding his family. And he's like, he's on the way to being sort of like a Mahmoud Darwish of art.
Yeah. So.
And he has no, and he's struggling, and he's having to actually go out in public and say, "Someone's taken all my money."
Right.
So even without an actual art marketplace. Like, even just for doing the art in the first place, he might have got maybe some kind of funding. Anything's been taken from him in terms of his royalties. Okay.
So, I mean, what I find fascinating is that people will make art in any circumstance, and that will be a priority above everything else. And, you know, above the market, above, you know, I guess, intimidation and so many other things. Miranda.
Well, I was just going to just start by turning the question around. As a British person, I suppose I'd reframe the question, can art help build a better future for all of us? Being bystanders in a situation of radical injustice, of apartheid, shames us all and makes the world a more dangerous place. And I think that Britain in particular is haunted by its various colonial legacies, and our governments and collaboration with repressive regimes. So I think art's a good way of making felt presence, those presences, those things, those people that we're not meant to talk about or think about. And I think that's something that art's... that I can do as an artist.
I mean, so far we've really just been talking about Palestinian art and their expression, but you're speaking as someone from Britain. And I was actually, you know, wondering when that side of it was going to come up, because we're not just talking about Palestinian artists, we're talking about artists from around the world, especially, I guess, in the UK.
Well, I think something that Aimee was sort of touched, well, maybe other people have touched on, is can art help make things worse for Palestinians.
Yeah.
And I'm going to just quickly say that yes, it can, and put forward the argument that British artists going to Israel can make things worse. And to talk about the British, just to give a case study, the British music group Alt-J have just been performing, actually they're performing tonight, I think, in Israel. Right. And despite a massive campaign to persuade them not to go. And I'm just going to quickly read a review from Monday's Times of Israel from Sunday night's performance. Israel's beautiful youth lifted by the gospel of Alt-J. That's the headline. Sub-tagline is, an English band's soaring harmonies strike a chord with the soldiers of a year ago and tomorrow. I'll just choose a couple of lines.
Yeah.
This was a night out with young Israel, army kids and post-army kids and tomorrow's army kids. Barely dressed in loose, wispy tops for the girls and army unit t-shirts for the boys. Widely and wildly tattooed. Arriving in twos, threes and fours, but then coalescing into larger groups of friends and acquaintances and brothers in arms, hugging and hand slapping and standing shoulder to shoulder. This is by David Horovitz. I think he may be the editor, and he was the former editor of the Jerusalem Post. So I just want to talk about the way, despite artists' best intentions, again and again, culture is instrumentalized, and is instrumentalized in Israel, and that culture is very important to Israel's self-image. Being cultured is proof of being civilized, being moral, and to use Ehud Barad's racist term, evidence of Israel being a villa in the jungle. Because art soothes and reassures us of our humanity, and you know that's great and makes us feel good. But obviously, apartheid and ethnic cleansing are not cultured; it's the opposite. So, as artists, we've set up Artists for Palestine UK, and I think one small step that any cultural worker and artist can make is to make a public declaration of solidarity with Palestinian artists and their audiences and their communities by signing a pledge, just a simple statement of saying that you're not going to work under conditions of apartheid until things change. And to understand that art is about communication often and mutual understanding, but the problem with Israel-Palestine is not a situation of misunderstanding or miscommunication. It's a matter of policy, and that policy has to change.
When you say policy, whose policy are you talking about?
The government policy and...
the British government policy.
Oh, well, there's British government support for Israel's policies of apartheid.
Okay,
so
that's
what has to change. And until there's a price to pay by Israelis... And they are talking about the boycott a lot. Until there's a price to pay their privileged position, they're not going to give up that privilege. I mean, it's the same in any situation. And I just wanted to... finish up by saying, you've raised the point of art as intervention and the Israel's use as art as intervention to rebrand itself. And... of course, at the same time, it's denying, appropriating, and often destroying cultural heritage of Palestinians, and that's its long-term project that's been going on since 1948. But also, I just wanted to draw attention to one of our projects is, that's a form of censorship to bury another people's culture, literally bury, but also to... pro-Israel groups and individuals in this country silencing and closing down events. It's a really serious matter, and it seems to go unrecognized in the public discussion. And the two ways of closing down an event that contradicts an Israeli narrative is to accuse it of anti-Semitism or to accuse it of being unbalanced, whatever that means. But those terms work, and we're now trying to track these. I mean, this has been happening for decades, but I think it's important to put these things in the public domain. So I'm going to wrap up now, but we've been tracing, and you can have a look on our website, some examples of this happening. And if you know of this happening, then come and tell us, whether it's the Royal Institute of British Architects, whether it's individual artists being forced to take their captions down.
Can you give us an example, just so we've got something concrete to understand? Can you give us an example?
Well, one thing that's worrying is that if arts organisations and people generally are not aware of politically motivated attacks and smears, then what happens is a photographer called James Morris has made wonderful photographs on sites of the destroyed villages in Palestine. Very large prints, landscapes. He was exhibiting them at an art centre in Wales, and an individual came in claiming to represent various organisations, saying he was going to campaign to close down the exhibition and demanded they be taken down. The curator and the director of the theatre then were quite intimidated. Just said to reach a compromise, took down the captions, which tell the story of what's happened in these empty landscapes, and then defended that decision. In the end, the photographer got them to put them up before the exhibition ended. But I think what's important is that when this it's the fact that they were prepared to do that, that they didn't question, that they're so frightened because they were told that it was too political, it was too unbalanced, and it was anti-Semitic, and they were going to get various communities to protest against it.
Right.
So it's a problem that what those curators, what the organisations need to do is to stand up and not make yeah. disclaimers apologising for art, which is what they feel they have to do. But we need education for that to happen.
So, I mean, what you're saying as well is that there's a group of people in this country that actually are pushing that agenda, that the so-called balanced agenda or the agenda of...
Absolutely, yeah. And I'd say that in terms of the art market, I don't know anything about the art market really, but I know that I think visual arts is a very conservative world, and when we launched our pledge for Palestine, which you can read here, which has got about 1,000 signatures on it, signed by artists across different art forms, of all the art forms in visual arts, well, we heard stories of. People saying that we got emails saying we're going to blacklist all your artists.
Right.
And, you know, this is
I just want to put this out there to the audience at large. I've got this other microphone as well. I mean, has anyone in the room signed the pledge? Are people worried about being blacklisted? We've got someone at the back there. Maybe we can hear from you. I mean...
Isn't part of reasoning as an artist to sign a pledge like that, because that's why we create, and we don't care about the consequences, I don't. I think it's very important us as artists that we stand up for ourselves and our beliefs at this time, and we continue to create, because things will change. Ideas don't remain the same.
Right.
They will turn. We have to remember that. But the more of us who collectively join up together, We can make a storm. And something that I think you're thinking about Fadi Tabak.
Yeah.
Fadi's work is fantastic, but the thing is, like people like Irina, Maya, Naji, they sell, they get work out by Marrakesh, but a lot of their buyers are in Jordan and Egypt and stuff like that. The problem is that if we were to buy art from Palestine, then we send money by natural sources, we could be arrested for sponsoring right. terrorism. So, on every level, it's controlled. It's very, very difficult.
Okay.
So, as individuals, we're not going to achieve enough. So, we really have to collectively work together and make big splashes. And you're quite right about NGOs, and you're quite right about political art and what we can put on. But as artists, surely, the way we put things on, and the way this exhibition is, it shows that. That's creative in itself. We have to find other ways of doing it. Find our own spaces, put work on, build on the audience which we have for this, and build a movement. As part of the anti-apartheid movement, that's exactly what we did.
Right.
So I think there's a great way forward. And it's as Tabassi said, it's our responsibility.
Okay, so it's as artists, our responsibility. Are there any other artists in the audience, the wider audience, that have signed the pledge or are concerned?
I was just going to add a note on that I almost feel that I heard of some artists and some galleries having funders saying they were going to have money withdrawn because a certain artist that they were showing had signed the pledge. I actually think those artists will be all right because as artists we have lots of networks. I almost I wondered whether actually some of the curators
right.
and people whose jobs depend on those, might be more vulnerable in a way.
Okay.
I'm unsure.
Have we got anyone that works for an art institution or is the curator that's worried about this? Is that somebody? No. I guess we can find out about that later. But I mean, what about this question of what is? Do we feel responsible? Do we feel that we should be getting together, as this gentleman over there said, that we should actually we need to get together and we need to act collectively and this is the way to act collectively. Aimee.
Well, we're actually working in partnership with Artists from Palestine on a project called Make Apartheid History. And the idea behind that project is to bring together artists and activists and civil rights movements across the world to draw attention to what is a situation of apartheid in Palestine, but to strengthen those links of solidarity and to get people to take action in support of Palestinians. So it's something that we're doing. It's a sort of creative program or a program of creative events that are going to be happening over the next year. We launched it on Mandela Day at the South Bank, and we've got lots of different individuals. There's now a website called Make Apartheid History that you can go to. And the idea is it's also very much a platform for Palestinian artists,
right,
as well as international artists as well. So we're trying to do exactly that in terms of building a kind of movement.
I mean, I'm going to go back to this because I want to, for me, I like to hear like real stories, concrete examples. I like the story of the photographer because I can understand it. I mean, just going to, apart from signing this pledge, which I think is a good idea, I'm going to go and sign it later on. What about, what other things are happening for Make Apartheid History?
Well, the main focus is on boycott, divestment and sanctions in the many forms that takes, and it is essentially, if we're talking about what's a good or beneficial outcome for Palestinians, it's the three principles of the boycott, divestment and sanctions movement, which is to get back to the political situation, the complete withdrawal of Israeli settlements and the dismantlement of the settlements and withdrawal from the occupied territories. It's the restitution of Palestinian rights in terms of the rights of refugees. And it's also taking back the discriminatory laws that are within Israel against Palestinians. So those are the principles behind it. In terms of what kind of actions people can take, there are all sorts of different boycott, divestment and sanctions actions that are going on at the moment that we will be publicising. But the essence is we're trying to make mainstream both the notion of what's actually going on in Palestine as an apartheid and doing that through art, because it's something that people do connect with, and telling the complex stories as well as the more simple ones as well. And providing people with a platform to send or a springboard to then get more active themselves.
Yeah, completely agree. But we should also make mainstream standing up against apartheid. Like, it needs to be the obvious thing to do, where someone almost, it's just not plausible to have not been a signatory on this pledge.
Yeah. So how do you do that?
I personally think it's education. I'm part of the Artists for Palestine group as well. And one of the things that was talked about was, how do you go about, we have the initial signatures when we signed, and then as soon as we launched, we had a few hundred more sign up, and that was great. But then how does that continue to grow into 2,000, into 3,000? And I think a lot of it is education about people who, about the situation, to people whose livelihoods are the arts, like you were saying about curators whose their job is on the line, that's where their money comes in. Across the board, lighting directors, stage managers, stage designers, the smallest element of every aspect of art, the music producer, the guy who mics up, the sound engineer at a venue, you know, because opportunities come and they might get the call from some production that is funded by Brand Israel, and you know, it needs to be completely across the whole board, and it needs to be so obvious. When we were launching, there were a lot of big names who didn't sign, who are completely pro-Palestine, and
why didn't they sign?
It's a lot to lose for a lot of people.
Yeah,
one person I know was he was about to sign, he was going to sign, and then a lot of things happened in the public eye, and he was like, I just can't do it now.
Yeah,
you know, it will destroy me. He won't work for ages. That's the mindset.
Yeah,
putting your head above the parapet is very difficult. for a lot of people, and I think that the education that you will survive, that you will be all right, and you're part of this movement, you know, history look back on you as being someone who stood
an
up for what they stand.
I mean, I'm going to go back to the wider audience and ask them to put their head above the parapet. What do people think about this? Are there any creative people in the audience? You look like you might be able to say something. I don't know. But I mean, what other people? I want to know. I mean, are people actually like making this step? I mean, why are you here today? Do you want to find? Oh, we've got someone over there. You can take this one.
I'll reach out. Hi, I'm Chris. I'm from Amos Trust, and we're a creative human rights organisation working in Palestine for 25, 30 years. Garth, our founder, when he first released an album about Palestine, lost half his audience immediately. He was speaking to a Christian audience at the time, and immediately he wasn't welcome at loads of different things.
Yeah.
For us, we've been involved in lots of different projects. Loads of people have signed up on that. One of the things we believe most strongly is to take people there. And we take a number of artists over to a festival in Bethlehem every year.
Right.
Purely on the basis that actually as people see, hopefully they are able to respond. It doesn't mean we're giving them an easy ride. Lots of people say we fuck up their lives. And that's a simple reality. We know we do. But that's why we got involved in the first place, because we go over there, we see a dreadful situation.
Yeah.
For me, as someone involved in a campaign organisation, I find most of the things we have to do sap the life out of me. Writing to MPs is the most boring thing in the world. I mean, we all know that. All those things, they take away everything which actually motivates me to be involved, to respond to the dignity which I see in the people I meet when I go to Palestine and around this table. For us, it's the arts which actually motivate us. It's my attempts to be creative and to respond the creativity which I believe I'm born with, which enables me to move forward. To see a piece of art, to read a book, to see something which actually speaks to my heart, I know works with other people. Yeah. And for us, I think the campaign has absolutely no chance of moving forward unless we're enabling that heartfelt response.
Yeah.
Because everybody knows it's wrong. I mean, there's no rocket science to know it's wrong, but unless you get it in the heart and you meet people and know people, you're not inspired to act because there's so many other places which are wrong.
It comes back to that sense of freedom that you brought up and that sense of like being able to be creative in a free space, knowing that this is happening in the world, I suppose, and somehow marrying that together. I don't really know what I'm saying here, I'm just connecting.
Well, I think it's compulsion as well. I think actually we got places we're compelled to act, and in that I think the key thing of all these organizations is helping people to do that, because actually you get shut down very quickly, you feel shut down, and unless someone does hold your hand through that whole thing, it's really, really difficult. And people have the right to grow up and make mistakes in public. It's really important we do, but that's so desperately difficult. And we know as campaigners when someone steps over a line, we slam them down very quickly. And we've got to somehow let that happen a bit more than we do.
Well, I mean, just once again, I'm going to same question. Give us an example of that actually happening, where someone stepped over the line
without naming names. I'm trying to think of one which doesn't name names and which everybody around the table isn't going to guess who I'm talking to
about.
Let me do it in a slightly different way, which doesn't sort of land anybody in it at all. For us, we bring lots of people back and we say to them, tell your stories. And we know that people coming back from trips so often blow what they say. They get the message so wrong.
Right.
And we either have to say to them, don't speak, or say, it's okay to get the message wrong. Because the people who are saying your message is wrong is actually the people who are wanting to maintain the status quo. And we have to be in a place where it's not just what we say can be wrong, it's actually some of our art can, if you like, can be wrong.
Yes,
and actually we can make those mistakes. And we know a couple of people who've been commissioned to do work by people who we've said to them, for goodness sake, don't do that. Because you'll be horrified by some of the other things they do. And the temptation when they took those commissions was to kind of walk away from them a little bit. Actually, it was to stay with them and hold their hand and say, look, actually, when it did fall to pieces, was to stay with them and say, actually, it's okay. We'll help you through the next stage here.
Right.
But I can't say who it was or what it was, because it would land a lot of people into lots of trouble. Yeah.
Okay.
Sorry.
I want to bring in some more people from the... Oh, there's a point. Come forward. Who are you pointing at? This. Okay. What's your name?
Aladdin.
Yeah.
I want to give some concrete examples, but yeah. First of all, I just want to say we need to break away. I mean, there needs to be change. We need to break away from this very binary otherization, good, bad, them and us.
Otherization.
Palestine and non-Palestinian.
Yeah.
And art and culture have a role to play, because the representation of Palestine and the Palestinian is invisible worldwide. And when it does crop up, it's interesting, but it's kind of branded in an interesting way. I mean, sometimes you talk about brand, and I think art and culture have a really strong role to play in refreshing the brand about Palestine, a much more representative one. Also, Palestine is not a monolith. The Palestinian is not a monolith.
Yeah, it's a massive group of people.
When Scarlett Johansson was an ambassador for Oxfam, little did she know that they were doing a lot of work in Gaza. Well, she did. But of course, when she was then being paid millions to be a spokesperson for a company which was in the occupied territories, she, yeah. Of course, resigned from Oxfam as an ambassador. That was the highest count of the word Palestine outside of warfare.
Really?
In a period of about 3 or 4 years, if you want to do Google counts. So Scarlett Johansson resigning. Then you look at, for the art world, let's say the Lacoste Prize, yeah, about 3-4 years ago. Remember that artist?
Larissa Sansour.
Larissa Sansour. Now, I commissioned her for the Venice Biennale 2011 project, The Changing Room. And some of you may know this, but the closing chapter of the Cultural Olympia at London 2012 Festival was actually The Changing Room as well. And the cover picture.
The closing
project of the London 2012 Festival and the Cultural Olympiad was The Changing Room.
Right,
so the
British
Council paid for it to come to London, and as you know, I put it on here.
Right.
And again, we had this problematic cover picture, which was bringing Jerusalem made by Arabs to London. And if you remember the Lacoste Prize, when Larissa was shortlisted, it was like, okay, her work seems good. But as soon as they saw the images, they said, oh, what is that? And that's when they said, oh, she's Palestinian. And also, oh my goodness, this is quite problematic. It might be anti-Semitic, the work, and so on.
Right.
I mean, I have, you know, you have the book, I've given it to you, but you know, the cover of the Changing Room project is Larissa's image. So I think we need to refresh the idea of what the Palestinian is and is not the bomb-carrying person or the person who is, you know, always under the yoke, because there's a much more empowered sense of what Palestinians and Palestine is about. So I do feel art and culture have a strong role to play there. The whole thing about art as intervention, as some of you know, for 4 years I was in charge of culture, media and sport in London. I chaired the culture strategy group, so I was in charge of, you know, everything from culture diversity to the whole Olympic bit happening. One of the key things for us was that, yes, you can instrumentalize art and culture if you actually want to make a proper representation of a plural society, if you want a flourishing society with all the dichotomies and all the oppositions within that. And I think I'm not really with the idea of good and bad in this. I just feel that art and culture is doesn't need to take sides. It just makes, it can make things visible. And
it's,
then we can approach that reality.
Yeah.
We need to share knowledge about the world. The biggest problem in the world is that there are enclaves of knowledge and people use knowledge as power. And so my whole thing on art and culture is, and from my experience, I did a project called Minority Report in Denmark, in Aarhus, I think it was in 2003. The European Union gave us about £100,000, and I remember late at night, some of us had to go around the bus shelters and the plaque, the billboards in Aarhus, to put black tape across a few lines of Arabic writing that appeared in our posters, because some politicians felt that this was a threat and invasive to Danish culture, and they felt quite problematic, they found it very problematic that there was something in a language they couldn't understand. Perhaps it was about Palestine, perhaps it was about terrorism, they didn't know. We had to put black tape all over that, you know.
So just the Arabic script itself.
Just the Arabic script itself was, and I pointed out, I said, look, there are all these McDonald's and Starbucks signs, nobody seems to be worrying about that. And if you talk about Danishness. So when we brought the Changing Room to London, just to pick up on a lot of the conversations here, an interesting thing, post-colonial stuff, all the bombings going on, the British and Americans, 2011 onwards, a lot of the artists who were at the changing room, they were from countries who were highly implicated in insurgencies. And for their work to come out here in London as part of a big imperial kind of propaganda of the circus of Olympiad was quite a difficulty. And we had this conversation for a year, really, about whether their work was about trying to make money and sell this stuff, and this is a great platform, or is their work much further than that? Right. Is it really about connecting to people? And in the end, we felt it's about talking people to people, which is why we chose not to put it onto mainstream spaces, as you know. But I think rebranding and refreshing the idea of Palestine is very necessary.
Right.
I think artists from Palestine coming out here, and British artists reflecting and representing Palestine in its entirety or in its complexities is important.
I'm going to ask you a question. Would you call yourself a curator? Or
it's one of my different hats. Yeah. You know?
I mean, it's putting on Palestinian work. I mean, it's obviously been possible. You've done it. But how hard is it? How do you overcome the...
Incredibly hard. Our biggest ally was the British Council. And right. I think the British Council then is different to today. This is now 3 years later. And I think, you know, it's not just 40% cuts, but it's also about the idea of, you know, what is Britishness? Should we be doing this? Should a society which is, you know, if you're funding artists from the public purse, do you need them to kind of toe the line? And it seems we're being asked to consider artists making stuff on Britishness, maybe, because that was an issue in Denmark.
Right.
And it still is. So it's a problem.
A lot of food for thought there.
It's interesting to hear you talk, because in a way when I stood up to think to speak, it was almost at the opposite sort of side to someone with lots of influence and lots of power and sort of feeling as an artist. Although I've worked with other artists for the last 20 years, small arts organisation, and worked with artists from Palestine. Over those years, we only managed to bring two from Gaza. It was always very, very tricky, but we did. And Larissa was also an artist that came. But I was listening to everybody and feeling, as an artist here in London, a painter, and why I haven't signed the pledge, because I haven't got around to it, because in the back of my mind, I was thinking, I'm so insignificant.
Yeah.
This is such a huge problem. And how do you feel that this tiny drop in the ocean would make a difference? But I do know several friends who have signed, who I think they're more important than me.
Right.
And I will sign, because now I sit here, I realise that every single one of us have to do everything we can, however small, and, yeah, make that point.
That's good.
But I'll give you an anecdote, because you like anecdotes.
Yeah, it's not just me, it's the whole audience likes anecdotes.
And as I say, a number of friends have signed, and one of them is Sasha Craddock, and she's a very good friend. And I don't think she at all would mind me telling this story, because she's a big supporter of Palestine and one of the founders of Art School Palestine. But when she signed, she got a message that a very important, I don't know their name, so I don't have to give it away, important Jewish pro-Israeli funder of the arts, someone who funds a lot of the major museums and galleries in London, sent her a message saying, you can't do this. You can't sign that pledge.
Yeah.
Sasha's not the sort of person that you tell what to do. So Sasha got someone to call this woman up and say, I'll come over and see you. So the woman was very surprised that Sasha turned up for tea.
Yeah.
And sat there and drank tea with her and listened to this woman rant at her and tell her in no uncertain terms, this is something you can't do and all the reasons you can't do it. And Sasha said, it's been really interesting listening to you, and left very politely with no intention of taking any notice of what this woman had told her. But I think she was most surprised that Sasha actually just went to hear her. And she said, because of course you can go and listen to what anyone's got to say.
Yeah.
You can be all ears to everybody, but no one can tell you.
I mean, was it similar reasons to things that Miranda mentioned, like this kind of, this question of balance and the question of being anti-Semitic? Were they the kind of things
course,
that came out?
Of course, that's always the language that's used, and it's so simplistic.
Right.
I think it's also about
when people say, oh, it's anti-Semitic, it's like shutting down the debate. That's the end of the discussion, and that's what makes people scared. I think it's really, it's intimidation.
Okay.
Yeah, I was in Gaza in June meeting artists, and I'm hoping to bring an exhibition to Manchester next year, or possibly the year after. And again, I'm just feel Chris spoke earlier about that compulsion, and you said, you know, just to do something positive and to be part. And the gentleman over there working together. And it's great for me coming down from Manchester, where I feel quite isolated as a curator working in Palestine and Gaza, to meet people like yourselves and to be part of a wider network.
I mean, just going back to, well, we say in Manchester you feel isolated. Is that, why is that? Is that because people just don't know about it? It's not a concern for them, or?
No, I mean, obviously, you know, Manchester, we are politically active, of course. You know, yeah. We have the Manchester, you know, Palestinian Solidarity Campaign. We have many, you know, Freedom Theatre. We're in Manchester. Of course, we have many people, you know, very passionate. But visual arts, Manchester's more sort of football and music. Right. In terms of the visual arts, we have been on a journey recently with the Manchester International Festival, and also Liverpool Biennial have supported Palestinian art in the past, and also the Corner House Gallery has in Manchester has supported.
I mean, I guess my question was really more about like almost being on that kind of having to persuade people that this is.
Yeah,
definitely. I mean, how do you do it, and what actually strikes the chord?
There's a fear. Of course, there is a fear, because still most of the arts institutions are funded via the Arts Council, and of course we know that David Cameron is the chairperson of Friends of Israel UK. So we've just got to do something, and we've got to make these. You know, we've just got to continue. Creating platforms for Palestinian artists in the UK to hear their voice.
Can I give one anecdote about being insignificant? I don't like to define myself from nationality, and I have the privilege, not like Palestinians, to do so. I'm Israeli, so we have a state, so I don't need to define. I have a British passport, so it's more complicated. But when I exhibited here in a really minor art fair in Brixton, few images that relate to the Gaza war and the Nakba, and just put it on Facebook and send email for a few people that some of them I didn't know. After a few hours, I got a phone call of somebody cursing me, sending me to Gaza to die, and it was one of the trustees of museum, Tel Aviv Museum of Art. So sometimes you succeed to poke people, even without knowing or without intention, by really small things. What I would like maybe to ask, I curated a small, very small exhibition, some Palestinian artists, some British artists. Right. We did it in a local pub in Brixton because we couldn't find any other venues. I would like to hear about, we heard about pressure cooker, which is an amazing initiative, maybe other platforms of that people were involved in promoting the Palestinian issue in visual arts.
What other platforms are there? I think that was directed more towards you, Aimee. Other platforms? Are the platforms there? Are there people in the audience that could maybe provide the platforms of the future? This is about you guys as well.
They did that project with Larissa and Orid Asheri a few years ago. The novel of Vavala novel, wasn't it? But there are prominent, well, there are artists who are successful, whatever that means, who actually are collaborating across the region.
Okay, but what, I mean, I think your question was more about, you know, actually starting something, come out with new ideas, new shows at that more kind of grassroots level. We've got somebody over here. Hello.
I didn't really want to address that point. First, okay. I wanted to talk about, you talked about standing up to the Zionists.
Yeah.
Supporters of Israel and curators, and Kerry mentioned sound engineers, interesting. I used to be a sound engineer.
Right.
Which is why at this point, I'm surprised that nobody's brought up trade unions yet. Because
right.
I think if you have trade unions involved, especially if you've got you know, lower level workers, people working like sound engineers, stage managers, things like, people like that, if their trade union says to them, if you stand up for Palestine, we'll support you, right. They're much more likely to do it.
Okay.
And I say this from experience, actually. I actually used to work at the BBC, and I used to have regular arguments about Palestine, but I never felt strong enough to say, no, I'm not working on this programme because of this. However, my trade union, Bechtu, did have a strong policy on BNP's party political broadcast.
Right.
So when that happened, I said, I'm not working on this programme because I knew I had the support of my trade union.
Right.
And my manager wanted to sack me. They weren't able to because my trade union supported me and managed to stop that. And
So trade unions have got a role, and possibly even providing a platform as well, because trade unions can do that.
But there's also, I don't know if people are aware of this, there's employment law now that says you can't be discriminated against for your political beliefs. This is quite recent, so a lot of people are not aware of this. But also the way this works, it's not specifically about political beliefs, it's actually about philosophical beliefs.
Right.
So the way it works, if to defend someone because of their political beliefs, is they have to hold these beliefs quite deeply. So if you're a campaigner, or if you're, for example, if you've signed up to the Artists for Palestine statement, you can say, this is my strongly held political belief, and so you know that can help you. But people are not aware of this. And also, because of the limitations, again, it's important to get the trade unions involved to support people.
I just want to ask, how many people here are members of a trade union? There's a few. That's good. Okay. So, what's that? Yeah, it should join. And has anyone got a view about what trade unions, what are they supporting, those who want to... if you just want to pass, and maybe come a bit forward, because we're having trouble with the radio.
Trade unions, we actually created this pledge, political pledge. So I think that's a very good way forward. I think we should stop apologising, because actually we should just look at artists. The work is fantastic. It's just amazing. And look, Person Arts Festival started last year. As I said, we have a lot of people, and Gil, as you know, we've built ourselves up. But the point is, we have threats. I mean, I have people that come into my house. Through Grindr, a guy from, allegedly from Mossad, he was dressed as a Palestinian, turned out to be an Israeli, and then Electronic Intifada had outed him as a Mossad agent.
So I went to deal with it.
I mean, it's intimidation, and I've been threatened, all sorts of things, but we didn't care. We've got a group of people. Look, the art is very good. You know, we just have to collectively work together. It's Balfour's centenary in 2 years' time. This is our first year. We're going to do something. We've already got a project. We need help. We've got this great project for next year. We've got fantastic people involved. Now, for 2017, we're going to do a massive project. And we should all collectively join up together. And remember what the Balfour Declaration was, and then start from there. Look, last week, there was an elderly jury.
What was this Balfour Declaration?
Balfour talks about, yes, there might be a land for Jews, but it's not at the chagrin of the indigenous population. I mean, we must never forget that. And also, I can't, somebody would have quoted much better than I can. Now, let's collectively make a pledge that we're going to do something big for 2017. Let's continue what we did today.
See when you say something big? What do you see?
I think we should do concerts. I think we should have lots of events for the whole year. I think we should find our own spaces if we won't go to other people's spaces. Look, we're going to take over a space. I had an idea today, and we'll find it. Look, finding money. There's loads of money. Just come up to Edgware Road with me, and we'll get them to give. There's an Egyptian guy who's very pro-Palestinian.
Right.
We're going to try and get money out of them.
Okay.
So there's lots of things we can do, and the fact is, us as artists, let's use all our creativity to fight the system, because it's basically a lack of communication, as Alan said. It's a lack of understanding. Let's try and help them understand where we're coming from.
Okay, using our creativity to fight this problem.
I just wanted to come in on, there's been a lot of talks about sort of very active anti
Palestinian sort of behaviour and the threats around.
The
threats around that. But actually there are some other really big issues that are much more under the surface that I just also wanted to touch on about access for Palestinian art and artists coming here and some of the problems that organisations have been experiencing in trying to bring people to the UK to actually display their work or to perform. I'm working also on a project which is trying to get more information from organisations about Palestinians who have been refused visas to come here. And the situation on the visas is very difficult for Palestinians to prove that they are coming here and that they're not going to stay, not only for Palestinians, but for anybody from the Middle East and beyond. But also in terms of bringing art over as well. I mean, I noticed Jon Snow's walked in the room and I know he brought the art in order to get the art out of Gaza.
Newsreaders bringing art out.
Well, I mean, obviously that isn't a sustainable situation, but I mean, these are the many underlying problems that people are facing and small organisations are facing. And I'd love to hear from James a little bit more about how he's working with artists from Gaza and how that's going to work out in an exhibition.
Okay. I mean, I just want to go back to this point as well. And the last thing that you said about using creativity, because that's really what I want to hear. And it sounds like we have to be creative, actually. And the example of bringing this artwork out would happen in a kind of creative way. So, James, how do you do it? How do you get the art out? How do you get the artists to so we can see them, talk to them?
Well, for me, it's a collaborative process. I mean, I've been to Palestine a few times meeting artists, and I just went to Gaza for the first time this year in June and made contact with a couple of galleries, forgive my pronunciation, somebody might help me.
Sorry,
the Windows Shababek Gallery and the Eltika Gallery, and just started a conversation, really. And it was an invitation, really, to work with the artists rather than to impose a curatorial theme upon them. But it was just sort of to work with them to give them more opportunities to exhibit in the UK. Really, so it was the beginning of that conversation, and I'm hoping to go back again in November to continue that conversation. I'm sort of speaking to having tentative discussions with galleries that I've worked with in Manchester and the Northwest, most recently the People's History Museum in Manchester, and also I've had a conversation with the Liverpool Biennial. So just testing the water, really. Obviously, I want to put money in the artist's project, money in the artist's pocket. So I'd like to be able to offer them new commissions to create new work. It's important to collaborate with them on the theme. So I'm not imposing my political framework
upon them. You're giving them a space.
Exactly. I'm offering them a chance to promote themselves and another opportunity, an ongoing opportunity. And I'd be delighted to work with Ash from the Palestinian Arts Festival to maybe we can have a Manchester satellite
that could be part of it.
Because again, it is about working together and supporting each other. And
I mean, I'm also going to put that question to you because you're saying you managed to get some artists to come and visit, but it's quite hard to actually get them into the UK. Would you say that's the case?
Yes, and I think something that various people have touched on is, you know, funders and when they have their sort of certain boxes that they're ticking. So, yes, British Council helped us with a number of those people, but I'm sure if we applied now, it would be a different case. So, also an organisation like Ford Foundation, which, you know, a number of years ago decided they would not fund anybody from the Middle East to go anywhere, whereas, you know, they used to work with us. So, I think it's even more difficult than it's ever been. But we try to always work through very small networks of artist to artist. So, you know, one artist recommending. So it was a very, very small network that we worked with.
I think funding is a real issue, and I think as well as thinking about platforms and opportunities, it's like that sort of information about how you fund the work, because it is really important to pay the artist.
Apparently there's an Egyptian guy up there,
all go to Edgware Road, but yeah. We commissioned this work from Marge Dow, so we raised money, and most of it came from an anonymous donor.
Right.
And he's someone who's, semi-public figure, and I don't know why he wanted to remain anonymous, but that's really interesting. I think maybe because of the sort of work that he does, he wants to travel and talk about stuff and write about stuff, so he didn't want to be impeded in that. But I think, you know, I work as a fundraiser, and I raise quite a lot of money for projects that I do here, but it was really hard getting money together for this. So I think that's also a challenge, and it'd be good to kind of like also have a brainstorm, maybe not tonight, but in the future, about that, how our collective minds can actually address that issue, because it is really, it's a thorny one. And even like transferring the money to Marge Dell, I was on the phone trying to open a bank account for about an hour and a half, and the woman just kept disappearing. She's going, what are you doing with this money? It's going to Gaza. Like, and what's it paying for? And she kept disappearing for like blocks of time. I was thinking, is she on the phone to MI5? What's going on? Like, it was just this silence and weirdness.
Did you manage to open the account?
No, in the end I gave up, because they wanted a solicitor's letter saying how we were going to use the money, and that would have used up all our funds. We tried to get someone to do it pro bono. That was really difficult. So in the end, I put it through another bank account, and actually we went to the bank to make a payment, and the cashier said, we don't make payments to Gaza. And I was like, well, you do, because this is the second payment. So there are all these little kind of things, these little obstacles, you know. Yeah.
So it can be done, but there are obstacles. I'm just going to, who are you? Kareem.
I was going to say something about the network and things like that, and about rich Egyptians in Edgware Road and stuff. There's plenty of them, and there's many, many rich Palestinians. The problem, if I can talk for or speak as one second as put on my Palestinian community hat.
Yeah.
There is a lot of money, there's a lot of bad blood, there are a lot of factions, there's a lot of censorship, there's a lot of feuds going back a long way. We can't deny that this is happening. And they, Palestinian groups, when we tried to work with them, because I'm also part of another activist group that do certain things, and I guess it goes on to building networks. When you try and get a Palestinian group involved in something, sometimes you get resistance from other Palestinian groups, and then you have people falling out, and then you have a lot of pressure.
Right.
There are many rich Palestinians, and in Manchester as well, I know one girl, I'll hook you up.
Yeah.
minted. Right. Unbelievable.
Yeah. Yeah.
But he's actually very involved in the arts with a couple of specific groups. And it is about getting the network that we're all talking about and opening up the door, because it is the Palestinian narrative. It's not our, now put my English out on.
Yeah.
It is not our narrative. It's there. We talk about talking about Palestinians, and we say about humanizing them or changing what people think, and they're not bad people. I mean, when we did the theater thing, there was a comment at the end. I mean, it was like she was surprised that the Palestinian had one head. Do you know what I mean? It was like, oh my, you know. And but the problem is, that is what you face by people who are educated. It's not, you know, the amount of times you say, what's your background? Oh, Palestinian. Oh, Pakistani. No, unfortunately, no, it's Palestinian. Where's Palestine? And then you go through it, like every time you have this conversation. Yeah. So it's up to them how they want to be viewed. And that's my English hand. It's up to us out there. It's up to it's really, really difficult. It's up to a Palestinian artist how they want to be viewed, and it's up to the Palestinians how they want to be taken. The media and whatever lobby group or whatever will always put the worst connotations on a Palestinian that they can possibly do. Well, because it's always happened. It's the other. It's not where they're interested in. Someone said about British interest in like the colonial history and stuff, and I was at a talk after the siege was shown at Battersea Arts Theatre, and someone was asking why is Britain British media and why are Britons interested in the issue all of a sudden now that they've seen it on the news? Well, because the drones that dropped the bombs on Gaza are made near Birmingham. You know, we have, as English people, British people, taxpayers, there are businesses on this land that still kill Palestinians, however you look at it, whether it be people investing in these arms companies. So the networks have to be, it's great that some people can stand up to intimidation, but there are a lot of people that can't.
Yeah.
And we, the networks that we create almost needs to be like an informal trade union, and so grassroots that an artist who is Palestinian from this country can go around the country and work. And when we managed to get Palestinians over here from the West Bank, Gaza, from the camps, because we're forgetting about the camps. I understand that we're talking Israel, Palestine, but the camps are part of the solution. We are growing in number, and number gets worse and worse and worse if you look at the news now. And again, that's the Palestinian issue. So we need to keep the idea of Palestinians being at the forefront, and they need to be.
So a kind of strong and navigable network. I'm going to give you this mic because that one's playing up. So okay. There you go.
Thank you very much. I hope this isn't going to sound too antagonistic, as it's been a very interesting discussion so far. I was just a little bit concerned about the focus on the kind of hardships and difficulties faced by those who've kind of expressed solidarity with Palestine, as opposed to the very serious dangers faced by Palestinian artists and other cultural practitioners, restrictions on their travel, censorship, harassment, imprisonment, in the worst case, assassination. So that was kind of, I hoped maybe we could discuss that. And the second thing was more of a kind of celebration and recognition of the thriving arts and culture scene that is taking place in Palestine at the moment.
How would you celebrate that? What's the best way in your mind to celebrate? I mean, we've heard about it a lot, and through the whole program of talks, and certainly we hear about it here, but
I'm sure it's something that everybody through every kind of area of work that they're involved in is very invested in. But I suppose I wanted to hear more about, when we're talking about how art can enable change and affect the future, I wanted to hear about change really kind of coming from within rather than necessarily this focus on our support, which is of course vital, but kind of how we can support more grassroots movements and art. I mean, that's what I'm involved in my work.
Is there a big difference? Aladdin earlier on said there are just artists. There's no difference between a Palestinian artist and an artist from somewhere else in the world. Where do you stand on that? Do you think that, sounds like you don't really agree with that.
I don't think it would be something for me or anyone else to define categorically. I think it's totally up to Palestinian artists to self-define themselves. And I think what we need to support is that ability of Palestinian artists to self-define themselves and ensure that we're not disempowering them at every stage of their kind of representation on international stages, which is critical.
I'm just going to pull this back, but I'm just going to come over to here because you talked about how do we celebrate this. Come and have a seat. We've got some seats on the front seats.
All right. Well, I'm going to do rather a long, rambling talk, I think, and you can pull me up at any point. My name's Sarah Beddington, and I'm an artist and filmmaker, and I've been travelling a lot backwards and forwards to Palestine over the last 7 years. I first went with Art School Palestine. I was part of a group of artists who was in the Liverpool Biennial, of which were Palestinian and British artists. And I've been and I also teach at the Art Academy in Ramallah. So I work a lot with Palestinian artists there. So I'm very kind of involved in many. But I came in very late, so I've only been here the last 15 minutes. I've sadly missed all the, I'm sure, wonderful things everyone's been saying.
You can actually watch this online. Where is it? It's going to be on our website, thepeoplespeak.org.uk, but also on the Gaze on Gaza website.
Okay, so I'll catch up
late. Yeah, you can catch up, but obviously you won't be able to respond to what people have
been saying. And I'm also signed the pledge as well, so
excellent.
I am, but I also very much agree with you about this sense of not creating the otherness in the art world, and I think a Palestinian artist. In my teaching, I always say to the artists there that don't be pressurized by Western curators coming in and trying to create you as a political artist, because already, you know, you're Palestinian, you're carrying this thing within you. You don't have to make work that's illustrating stuff that is actually, you know, is simplifying, and you can just make your work, you know, just...
Do you think there's a pressure to them package themselves, these art students?
There's a huge pressure by the West for that fodder. It feeds a machine, it perpetuates a machine of what Palestine is or is seen by, whether it's the art world or whether it's a more Zionist sense perspective. Yeah. So I think there are ways of creating platforms where we discuss things. It isn't about collaboration with Israelis, not at all, but it is actually about looking at each other and not creating this difference and finding spaces where we can look at work and discuss things that are slightly outside of this polarizing place, are slightly more thinking about the poetics or the absurdity of things, for instance, which theater does very well. Thinking about, film also, narrative film, fiction film, is a place where Palestinian filmmakers have made an incredible, indent in the world of film.
Earlier on, Kareem mentioned, and I think we've touched upon this all the way through this talk, this kind of the freedom, the freedom of the imagination and this free space, I guess, which you define in your own way, and that's been a sort of motif, I think, for this evening.
But can I keep going just a little bit? I think it's really important in this sense of getting the message out for people who have not been there. It is really very difficult to understand what's happening there unless you've spent time there, unless you've understood how the spatial confusion of how the occupation is about making people confused from within and to start an imploding situation where people start to attack each other rather than dealing with the larger politics. So when I did my residency with Art School Palestine, I wrote individual 20-page emails to my entire email address book, and I lost quite a few friends because I was living in New York at the time. I had many Jewish friends who we hadn't totally looked at things up front, and I lost a lot of people that way. But that was all right. Some of them have come back. I've said, look. It's not, I don't hate anyone. It's not about that. It's about this is what this fucked up situation is, and we need to talk about it. We can't just say, oh, lovely, let's have another canapé.
Yeah.
Because, you know, it doesn't work like that.
I mean, is there a sense, and I might just be projecting this, but like, that if you are curating a show with some Palestinian artists that you're kind of dealing with, you know, you've kind of done that, you've done Palestine, and you've kind of, like, you've done your bit to sort of, like, you've come to the show, do you know what I mean? That, okay, we sort of, you know, you feel better about Palestine. Is that what you're saying now?
No, I'm not at all saying that. No, yeah. It's an ongoing concern of mine. I make work in other places in the world as well, but I'm still working on a documentary film which is looking at the problem of the refugees outside of Palestine, in particularly in a camp in Beirut, where, again, you know, the refugees are off the agenda really largely. So what I'm talking about is no, oh, I can't remember what your question was now. I'm sorry.
But don't worry. Just ignore it. Just ignore it. That's not, you know, just go, carry on with
I'm
this train
of
thought.
I'm having a bit of a rant. No, I'm not meaning to. I'm just trying to pick up on the threads that I've heard in the room, although I arrive late, and just talk about where we can go. That's not, you know, that's not about polarizing things, but actually finding a space where it's not brand Israel or brand Palestine. I do have an objection to that word, brand Israel. That's.
Brand Palestine. It's not. I was just saying when it's discussed about sort of brand Israel, I think a lot of people's instant idea is, well, let's just build up brand Palestine. I wasn't agreeing with it or advocating it.
I mean, what about this question? This question of like just allowing those artists that are practicing in Palestine to, you know, to have that free space. I think this is an important point. Have that free space and not. Be able to escape that politicization or that kind of packaging, I think, is probably a good word.
Yeah, of course. An artist is... you can sort of be seen as it being maybe a social pressure to be a political artist. It's like, you know, what do you do? Do you sing... For example, what verses of Wayne Aramullah do you do? Do you talk about the Intifada in that one? It's like, you know, there's a long history of it, because the resistance has been in the art for a long, long time. So every artist should have the choice to do exactly what they are feeling. There should be no pressure on that happening. Like, no, there should be no whether censorship or making...
Yeah.
The space should be as big as possible.
Yeah.
You going to talk about Brand Israel?
Just very quickly, in case people don't realise, when we talk about Brand Israel, this is an actual formal strategy of nation branding that was adopted by Israel. So it's not something made up by activists. This is something that the Israeli government funded and produced. I just wanted to add to, because this conversation has been incredibly wide-ranging, because it's a huge topic, artist yeah. intervention, can art help build a better future for Palestine? And we started with Selma and Kareem talking about, well, you was talking really from a very much from a practice point of view, and then we've talked about what international artists can do. We've really and I just want to say that none of these things, depending on what point you came into the conversation, mustn't be exclusive of each other. This all belongs together, and we must all do the little bits. And for some people, you know, signing a pledge is one thing that you can do. There was the fantastic discussion that happened here last week about Palestinian theatre. If we can actually do collaborations, if we can support an artist for Palestine, is very interested. We're just a network, really, but through that network of doing all sorts of things, including supporting visiting artists in whatever way we can. I think all of these things have to, you know, belong together. This is a very ambitious discussion, I think, and I think it's fantastic. And I'd also just like to say, in terms of artist intervention, what this small group, Gaze on Gaza, have produced is amazing. I'm really impressed, and the fact that we're having these discussions is a great intervention.
Okay, well, that's a great sum up for that, for all of this. Yeah, so that's great to take us into. I mean, we have gone from from talking about really Palestinian artists and what they're actually doing to the wider international community, and then, you know, back again, really. And now we're summing up.
Just going with Brand. I mean, we need to be fair. I'll be shouted on, but we need to have a pluralistic idea of Palestine and Palestine and Israel. So Brand Israel, I don't swallow. Like, I don't swallow Brand Palestine. I was in charge of Brand London, and there was a very variegated thing that was too. So what I was going to say was that I think the idea of a Palestinian Biennale would be interesting, a bit like Documenta. I was an artist at Manifesta 8 in 2009 when the theme was, what's the relationship between Europe and the Middle East and North Africa. And I remember in 2009 walking around Cartagena and Murcia in Spain, where we were having it. And I said, where is actually the Middle Eastern work? I couldn't actually see anything recognizably Middle Eastern or yeah. Arab even, or Palestinian even. And I think there is a space, somebody was talking back there about festivals, and there's a risk of ghettoizing, of creating further ghettoization, of ghettoizing Palestine, Palestinian, Palestinian culture. Just as Kareem is explaining, that you can't get two Palestinians who will be agreeing on things. So the notion of, you know, what's the end state that we are looking for? I mean, I think there is wide disagreement within Palestinian groups as well as non-Palestinians, but what's the end state? So if art and culture can make things better, what is that better going to look like? Nobody in this room will agree. Nobody around this table is going to agree. You know, as a person whose father worked and was in the same room as Arafat and Golda Meir, I grew up understanding the role of trying to bring people together. You can't stop. And I started off by talking about not falling into the trap of, you know, going along the binary route of just thinking there's this black and white. There is no black and white. You have to maintain and create dialogue. Art and culture, for me, is a very powerful way to put a discourse, a narrative out there which isn't being heard, and just let people discover it. You don't have to ram it down the throat like the branding people do. So my notion of brand is a less subjugated one. It's one where you just allow something to be present in its real voice. And those real voices is what is so interesting about this exhibition. We've all seen Palestinian work, but you come here, you'll hear other Palestinian voices. So we've got to find a way to bring the idea of Palestine and the idea of Palestine arts and culture out there in its plural and non-conformist, not politically correct shape. And this is the thing. It's okay. Not politically correct, you know.
Yeah. Yes, hi. Yes, sorry. I do agree about not ghettoising. I think that's really important. And the reason I wanted to grab the mic one more time is because working as part of the Artists for Palestine Collective, I've been in Edinburgh for the last week. And, you know, not ghettoising, mainstreaming. I mean, Palestine was really on the agenda this year. Right. Extraordinary. David Gregg, helped by the British Council, programmed a whole day on Sunday of Palestinian artists. There was this wonderful young woman performing artist. There was the Al Hara Theatre Group, who we saw on the Skype call. They were there doing Shakespeare's Sisters. Fantastic work. Musicians. There was a stand-up. I mean, it was a vibrant, wonderful day. That's just one day. I mean, next year, I think we should all be working together to try and inject the Palestine narrative, the Palestinian work into these kind of big mainstream festivals. There was David Gregg again working with Raja Shahadi and the British Council again, beamed live from Gaza City, a performance by Ashtar based in Ramallah, but Ashtar's Gaza group, branch, whatever they call themselves, straight live audience there, live audience in Edinburgh, fantastic stuff. And at the same time, right through the whole fringe, there's been, again, on the festival programme, there's been a Palestinian circus company.
Right.
Yeah, Palestinian circus school doing a play called Builders. One of them got injured. They were off for a few days. That's a shame. And then the thing called Walking the Tightrope, the tensions between politics and art, debate about little plays by, you know, real British playwrights. And after every discussion, after every performance, there were panel discussions with a whole succession of people like us on the panel.
So these things are happening.
Debating about BDS, about everything. And today and yesterday, the Israeli cultural attaché was there, and he was forced to confront members of Scottish Palestine Solidarity Campaign as partners on the panel. I mean, it's just unheard of. And Artists for Palestine UK, so great stuff, and
these
we can really build these things. I'm very excited about it.
Okay, so
you mustn't just be speaking to the converter. I mean, it's very important that arts and culture does... No, I'm with you, but I'm just saying that something also to keep on board is art and culture can reach people that politics doesn't reach. And we have to get normal people speaking to normal people, and that's what's so missing, and I think art and culture can do that powerfully, just like the stuff on the wall back here. The normal folks in the UK are about who can connect with that.
So,
and that's what we need to be getting out to, and, you know, sort of leapfrogging outside of the art paradigm. Just one thing, funding... Yes, I had a Jewish philanthropist support my project. George Soros put up the core funding that allowed the Biennale changing room in 2011. Okay, so I'll not hear a bad word said and tarring every Jewish philanthropist. I think we heard earlier about, you know, another one. But I think we need to be smart to use the kind of innovative, disruptive aspect of art and culture to disrupt and engage people who are not engaged at all. Because otherwise it becomes the same talking shops.
Okay.
And so a lot of money goes into that.
All right. I'm just going to say we're going to get final thoughts, and I especially want to hear from people that maybe haven't said anything yet. I want to get some final thoughts. There's someone over there. But over to Claire first.
Just thinking about, like, not just speaking to the converted and the lack of polarisation, I watched Five Broken Cameras recently, and then that was made by a Jewish and Palestinian sort of two individuals, two artists. Well, one of them wasn't an artist, he was a farmer, and he worked with an Israeli film director. And then there was also a sort of short documentary made when the film was shown to a group of Israeli teenagers. They were sort of like 14 years old. And they were really affected by this film, and they said, you know, we're just not exposed to this stuff within our education system. We just don't hear about these stories. And our sympathies were with the Palestinian farmer, what was happening to that village. We were very angry with Israeli soldiers. And it was just amazing to kind of see that, because you also don't, a lot of those narratives don't come out either. You know, it's kind of very kind of that polarization. Well, everyone feels like this, or there's that lack of exposure, but it does happen, probably on a very small scale, but a good example of it.
So that kind of like more, that more detailed texture.
I think.
Let's say. What we're going to do is we're going to not literally throw this mic. Someone, if someone can pass the mic. Oh, you're going to come even, yeah, there we go. You can come closer. Use this one then in that case. But then we're just going to pass this around and get some final thoughts from people in the audience and then our invited speakers. Actually, Selma, you've not said that much really today. But anyway, we're going to definitely get a final thought from you. But over to you.
Yeah.
Okay.
So don't go away.
Don't go away. Okay.
I want to emphasize a point I think Kareem said earlier about grassroots and empowering people as individuals. I mean, hearing things people have said about different things they see, like theatre groups and music and art, what I feel, I've worked in this space for 4 years, and what I feel is there's no sort of autonomy, there's no sense of collectivism. Everyone has a voice, but there's no sense of let's all collaborate and actually happening. Everyone says let's collaborate, but it doesn't.
Doesn't
in the
turn
end,
into collaboration.
There's nothing massive, and that's why every time there's something happening in Gaza or Palestine, you know, any like last year, Israel's propaganda can break through really quickly because our message is splintered. Everyone has a single voice, and it works.
Yeah,
that's it.
It's and a I think bit, there needs a bit to be more loose. Than
yeah, I think there needs to be more of an organised autonomy, more sense of collectivism and.
Right. So that voice needs to be more coherent and sort of everyone speaking as one in a way.
Yeah, regardless of Palestinian artists, non-Palestinian artists, I think as long as you're doing something positive for Palestine and Palestinians, I think that's it, really.
Okay. Let's get some final thoughts from... any final thoughts from around? Yeah, okay. I'm going to come to you guys in a sec, but anyone, this would be your final chance? Okay, is there someone behind the pillar? No. Okay. Can someone pass that down? Yeah, there we go. I'll turn it up quickly, and then we'll come to you. Yeah.
I just want to say two brief things. Am I on?
Yeah.
About accessibility and getting art out there. I mean, this work, I wouldn't have seen it. If it hadn't been on the news, an item on the news that the artist was not permitted to come. There was an interview with her talking about the piece, and yeah, there it was, this big piece about Palestine. You know,
so
it's
you've been
done to
yeah,
me, this
yeah.
Thing. And the other thing about getting out there, a bizarre thing. I mean, I'm not really an artist, but I haven't been making art lately. And I asked for a space in the Walthamstow Art Trail. And they gave me a central library, and they said you can have these four big windows. So suddenly I had to make four pieces, which I did, you know, a metre by a metre, or a metre by a metre and a half, actually. And I decided to make one of them about Palestine. Why not? And it was an image. It was about Gaelic women, and it was about enclavement and murder and taking of land. And I put up there for 2 weeks in Walmsley Central Library, which is not a great venue, but plenty of people go in and out, ordinary people. And it was just amazing. I thought they would never accept it.
But they did.
They did.
Okay.
And the other three pieces were sort of anti-colonial.
So within that context, it's a full round of applause. Okay. Any other final thoughts from the audience?
Just something that I'm feeling. That I should say, there are also Palestinians that live within the 48 borders, and they are feeling the proto-fascist government now really, really heavy-handed. So I don't know if people can do anything here, but need to be mentioned because they are in a really difficult situation now.
Okay, so you're talking about people that live within the borders of
Israel? Yeah, they have Israeli passport, but they are Palestinians, and they are not here and don't know there. So.
Okay. Any other final thoughts from the audience? Okay, I'm going to come to you in a second, but didn't you want to say something?
I did. I'm just going to say two very quick things. One is just a campaigning idea, which is so unlike me, but somebody mentioned about the Balfour, and I think if there was a date, one date that can be taken, a film which is very inspirational in terms of organising global campaigns is We Are the Many, looking at the 2003 campaigns and how they were coordinated around the world. So just as an idea of a date to work around with, given, you know, a period in advance something could be done. Second thing, because I'm literature, not art, I've been quite quiet tonight, but I do think there's a lot we can say which is depressing and negative, but I think with Palestinian literature, and this is very much reflected in feature films as well, I think that there's what happened with Oslo and the Oslo Agreement, and not very much that was positive came out of that agreement, which effectively legalised a lot of the occupation. But one thing which was fantastic was a new form of sort of iconoclasm which has come up in Palestinian society. And the way that it's reflected in art means that we're having writers who are coming out speaking much more personally about things and not wanting to toe the party line as much, or feeling a freedom from it. So that periods of recent history which have been forgotten, so, you know, Palestinians working as undercover agents in Europe are now being covered by brilliant writers like Misha Hiller. You've also got writers coming out of Haifa, like Khulud Khamis, writing about being gay as a woman in Haifa, as a, you know, multiple identities, and you've also got a lot of very powerful, I think, Jewish writers who are coming out on the Palestinian side who need to be embraced if we're going to combat this very lazy slander of being anti-Semitic. And also, there's been very enterprising work being done by a Manchester publishing house, Comma Press, who were in communication with Atif Abu Saif in Gaza. And when Gaza was being bombed, they encouraged him to write a diary. His diary's now being published. It's a very strong work. And I think that was an editor sort of taking the leap, forming that connection, moving with it. So I think there's a lot to be positive. Also, Ahmed Massoud, I should mention, as a new Gaza novel, which has just come out, which has, as a point of view, a perspective of a collaborator. And this is really quite a difficult one to take, but in a way, through taking that difficult position, you really feel that he's trying to ask, there's an internal message. This isn't just talking out as Palestinians. This is like saying, what have we become? How do we deal with the situation we are in, and how do we resolve that? And a plea for forgiveness on a Palestinian scale. And I think that's very powerful. So that's my sum up.
Yeah,
thank you
great
for it's interesting to hear from the art.
Come forward, come forward. Or we can pass you the mic actually if you want. Can someone just throw that one? Yeah.
I didn't think I was. Hello?
Yep, go.
Yeah, I didn't think I was going to say anything, but I just.
If you can come this far, I'm not sure you're
right, the table. Yeah. I just thought one of the most interesting things is what you said about the psychology of what it's like for people to be actually in Gaza. Because one of the unique things about Gaza is that it's restricted in and it's restricted out, and we don't know what it's like. And even if you go there, really, it's very difficult to even understand what it's like for people there. So I guess all I'm saying is that for me, as somebody that, you know, may never go there, it's like the most important thing is that I understand, or I can kind of get some insight about what it's like to be there. So if that's just maybe just a kind of plea for the more work to be available, more accessible, to be shown, it's about that. It's about that.
Yeah, and we've heard, I think, a lot, there's such a multiplicity of experiences there as well.
And I was just going to say that I think Sarah was talking about the West Bank. But I think that's an important point, that all of the, and you were just talking about Palestinians in 48 inside Israel. And I think it's true that hearing from the artists from these particular places can help us understand. And also, we've talked about whether we could do more artist collaborations or tours and take form of those relationships. And I think it's very important. And of course, the refugees, which you mentioned as well. So, yeah.
It's about the everyday. So it's you know, moving away from the political, even just about artists being able to make work and get some insight into the sort of everyday.
Yeah. Okay. Final thoughts.
Catherine, a date. So the date of the Balfour Declaration, the 2nd of November 1917. So 2nd of November will be the date.
2nd of November 20. We'll see you. Hopefully we'll meet before then, but we'll definitely... Final thought?
Sorry, not a thought. I hate doing promo, but if anybody would like to hear about the exhibition that I will be putting on here in January, which will be showcasing different visions of a future Palestine, then please chat to me about it at the end.
What's your name and when's the opening?
My name's Nadia and it's called Sadha Collective, and I'd be very happy to talk to anyone if they're...
And can we come to the opening? When is it?
It will be January 15th here.
Okay, fantastic.
But yeah, just...
Okay, more plugs now. No, I've got the ball rolling. A few plugs at the end here. Any final thoughts before the plugs? No? Okay. Okay, one last final. Keep it, yeah, concise. Brevity is the soul of wit and all of that.
Knows me too well. Once upon a time, the rest of the world found the idea of a sort of mainly Muslim state terrifying. Now, in the last few years, Daesh, Islamic State, has come along, and I wonder if we are in a different position now. And I think we will see how positive and strong a culture in a region like that, which can create a state solution against all odds, and with culture at its heart. So this is an interesting thing, because culture and arts are not alien to the Palestinians, whether you're Christian or Muslim or whatever. And I think, you know, I'm just struck that this is something which hasn't come up, because once upon a time, I'm 56, so in my time, I remember affiliation with Palestinian men, terrorists, bunch of terrorists, that's all you heard. So I'm just finding it quite interesting that we are in the shadow of this thing geopolitically. And so somehow they're looking for the good Muslim kind of creatures, you know.
Okay. Final thought?
No, it's a response to the Daesh ISIS thing. Unfortunately, I mean, if we're talking about I would know specifically about Daesh from London, and the problem is it is linked culturally, because I mean, a lot of people in this room have probably met a lot of the people that are out there, and that's a sad thought. They were rappers, writers, artists. The reason that they've kind of gone that way is completely social situations, economic situations. I could go on about it for all night. But from this country's kind of perspective and the situation here, the situation with it in Palestine is just something I heard the other week from a English woman that is married to a Palestinian in the West Bank. And she's actually had to live in a village which is full of... it's got a big reputation for collaborators from the Intifada, where Israeli soldiers could go, no problem. That was their safe haven. And so she lives with not much money in this village that is known for collaboration, hated by her neighbours. And in any of the sort of neighbours in the neighbouring village, this is just outside Ramallah, a lot of the Jabhat al-Shahabiyyah, the PFLP, Marxist... fighters and supporters from the 70s and 80s who are extremely secular and atheist or anti-religion, however they would pigeonhole themselves, following years of bereavement and following years of the opening of the media and the way that Islamic narrative and culture and the way that it's been turned in by people who say they are a religious leader and they're not, and satellite channels. These people are now, a very wide variety of them, going towards the more ISIS thing, the more ISIS ideology, which is, for me, it's absolutely scary, because, I mean, even like the PFLP had a huge artistic idea, and so much stuff came from that. So now these people are now going the complete opposite, where even art and culture might be... Man, I don't want to end on a really sound note. I literally just found out the other day about this, and I mean, it took me a while to get over it. But how art then progresses within these cultures, within these situations, whether the West Bank, the camps, or Gaza, or in 48. I mean, it's a big barrier, but hopefully, it won't. You know, it'll keep going and it'll break down the walls.
I mean, I was about to say this is ending on a really positive note, but then always with every, you know, this is the way things work, I guess, in the world. I guess we'll take that as the final thoughts, because I think we're going over time. But let's just quickly, where's that book gone? I want to talk about this book, which is Selma's book. She's got 3 copies left in the world. So, and this book...
£3.
£3.
An introduction by Camilla Shamsi, and it's all the questions you ever want to ask about why culture's at the centre of... If you're an artist, this is the cultural perspective yeah. on Israel-Palestine, and what, and it's a political argument, essentially.
Okay.
Very accessible. Oh, and these are these. If you want information about the Artist Pledge for Palestine, I've got these leaflets.
Okay, so talk to Miranda. And what's that?
So we're going to have some closing words from my Gaze on Gaza colleague.
Okay, all right. Okay, very, 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 very quick plug.
Very quick plug. The main subject of my film is called Fadia Lubani. She runs a kindergarten in Burj al Barajni camp in Beirut, which is about to fall down due to water damage. I've started a crowdfunding campaign right. called Save Fadia's Kindergarten, and she wants to make a theatre in the camp, and she wants to create links with the outside world. It's another way of thinking about how to connect all these different people together. So if anyone would like to contribute to saving her kindergarten, it's Save Fadia's Kindergarten. On GoFundMe. Thank okay. you so much.
Thank you, thank you. Okay. Can I take the red one? Oh, you want the red one. There we go.
Hi everyone, I'm Ella Saltmarsh. I'm one of the co-founders of Gaze on Gaza. And so firstly, thank you for this evening. And thanks for bringing such kind of energy to this debate. Like, it's felt like it's a conversation that really matters. And it's felt like a real opportunity for people to connect around this issue. And for us, that's extraordinary, because a year ago, we had never done anything in this space. We were people who were shocked by what we were seeing on our TV screens, and very simply had that compulsion to do something, and didn't have a clue what that something might look like. And so, tonight is the closing night of this exhibition, and we have got Ash in the room, as you've heard from the Palestinian Arts Festival, and we've got Joe from Christian Aid. You know, and together, you know, we've never come together as partners before to do anything, and it's been an extraordinary experience for us all. And I guess I wanted just to say a little bit about Majdal, because her work's been here this evening and we haven't talked about her very much. So, you know, the work was launched in Gaza on the 8th of July at an installation in Gaza City, and the 8th of July was the start of Operation Protective Edge. And tonight is the anniversary of the official end of Operation Protective Edge. And this morning, Majdal posted this photo on her Facebook page. And so when the show launched in London 3 weeks ago, you know, we really wanted Majdal to be here, and she couldn't be here. And in fact, none of the artists who were exhibited were here at the launch of their show. And so we sent Majdal a bunch of flowers in Gaza. Claire found a florist in Gaza City, and so on the day of her launch, she got a bunch of flowers, and she took that photo and posted it today to say that on, you know, the last day of her exhibition, the flowers are still alive.
Can I just say, Ella, that I had a lot of help from Christian Aid in finding that florist.
Okay. and so I was really touched by seeing that photo this morning. So I'm going to hand you over to Lena, who's going to have the final word. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. I'm going to keep it brief because it's been a long night. So there's one more picture to come up. I can talk without it if you can't get it up. So basically, I'm going to tell you a very short story. I came last Friday to the gallery with my partner and my toddler, and I brought her, not because this is really a space for little kids, but because my partner wanted to see it and he hadn't seen it yet, and we couldn't get a babysitter, so she came as well. And she loved the space, she was very attracted to this and wanted to touch it. She didn't, don't worry. But she was attracted to it because it's beautiful and colourful and joyous, despite what it's about as well. And she loved being here because of the space as well. There was lots of space for her to run around. So I'm telling you this story because that visit reminded me of two things. And the first one was, as I don't know what she's gone. It reminded me of something Ella also said, why we came together last year, how you watch the news often, and how we watched the news last year and were so appalled by it. And perhaps last year I was even more shocked and horrified by it because I have had a five-month-old baby by my side, but I don't think that was just it. I watched and thought, what can I do as an individual? And that's been said by lots of you tonight. And so we formed Gaze on Gaza. And the second thing that the visit reminded me of was the issue of space. And I think it's been said by some of you here tonight as well, because space is a real issue for people who live in Gaza, not just in terms of the amount of land they have to live on, but also in terms of the freedom to move or the freedom not to move. And during the Shubak Festival here in London recently, there was an event called Visions of Palestine, and it showed three films. Ash from Palestinian Arts Festival was there as well and heard it. Michelle Cliffey was here, and he showed a short half-hour documentary. And he said something that I think has been touched upon by some of you as well, that we need to reframe how we talk about Palestine. We need to talk about human rights, because that's something we can all understand. And Peter Kosminski was on the panel and has done an eight-hour fiction film, or two hours for TV, said that Michelle in half an hour had said everything that needed to be said about Palestine. So I guess I'm telling you that because there's been lots of talk today about what we can do, and it's very easy for us when we watch the news to resort to commenting on Facebook or Twitter and feeling like we've done something. And actually, I guess I wanted to end with saying, I'm preaching to the converted, I'm sure, because you're all here tonight, and lots of you are doing stuff already, but encouraging you to go forth and do something and keep on doing something. And for a start, we have these little postcards that you'll find on the table out there. And I wanted to encourage you to take a postcard and write something. It could be one word, it could be a sentence, or it could be a short novel if your handwriting is very neat and tidy. And write something about how this exhibition and tonight made you feel, and we will post it for you. And then I just wanted to say thank you for coming tonight and to all our panelists.
If you want to continue the conversation, we're going to go to the Summertowns pub, coffee house. So it's just down the end of the street, you turn left, and it's just down the end of Charlton Street. So if you fancy it, please do join us, have a drink, and we'll continue chatting.